before you this morning with grateful hearts and with humble hearts, knowing that the God of the universe, a holy, majestic creator of everything, the God of before time, bigger than anything that we could ever imagine, loved us so much that he sent his son that was willing to pay everything to purchase us by the shedding of his own blood. God, I thank you that you love us the way that you do. God, I thank you for your son, Jesus. God, I thank you for the privilege of worshiping you. God, I thank you for just the opportunity that we have to come and praise you, to gather together, lift our hearts and our voices up to you. But God, I pray that because of what you've done for us, God, that we would surrender our lives to you completely. Lord, that every day we'd wake up and make the choice, make the decision to follow you, to surrender to you for that day, Lord, to serve you with our whole hearts. God, we want to love you with everything that we have because you loved us first and you gave everything that you had for us. And we thank you for that. We pray all these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.
I'm gonna be your hands, I'm gonna be your feet. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh man, what a great week we have. Let's get up for Pastor Matt, all he does, and put this up. This is worship, and Madeline, I started to say Madonna, but it's Madeline, right? Yeah, and then John on the, what do you call that thing back there? Yeah, something like that. And then, you know, Brandon on the bass, and our oldest teenager, Seth, leading us in worship. Whoa, give it up! I had the privilege of preaching last year for Pastor Mike, and thanks again, Pastor Mike, for giving me the privilege of preaching this morning. I was telling the first service, a lot's happened in last year. Man, back in April last year, my oldest son and his wife gave birth to their third little baby boy. And then in May, my number three son, he got married. Then in September, my number one son brought their number two little baby girl home from the Haiti that they adopted. The end of September, my little baby girl, my fifth child, she got married in September. And actually, 2 weeks ago, my number two son and his wife gave birth to their firstborn little baby girl, man, Adeline Chris. He's so pretty. She ain't ugly like I am, you know what I'm saying? She got her grandma's jeans, that's right. But I'm so excited to be here this morning. Let's do this. Would you pray with me? And let's just ask God to speak to our lives this morning through His Word. Father, Your Word is what carries the truth for us. It's God, Your Word is what speaks to us. God, You speak through Your Word. God, You empower Your Word. And God, we live by, we count on these words, God, You've given to us. And so, God, this morning as we open up Your book of life, God, Your words, that Father, I pray that we would hear, not just with our ears, but with our hearts, and that also, because of that, God, our lives are changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks for praying with me. I was thinking how most of us, well, probably all of us, we're all pretty much a lot alike. When you really think about it, we all kind of like just the bottom line. You ever been in a phone conversation with someone and they keep talking and talking and you know what they're trying to get to and you just want to go, say it, you know? And I remember my first son, when we went to go buy his car, we went to the car dealership and we met the car salesman. I thought I struck up a deal with him, but then he had to go back, I think, and talk to some other, like, manager, and evidently he had to talk to, like, another manager, who then told this manager to tell the sales guy, here's kind of maybe where we'd meet in the middle. I was like, I just kind of want to go bottom line, man. And so by the time I got to my third son, we're looking for his car, he turned 16. My wife's on the school board with a lady named Stevie. Now Stevie, her husband, owns a car dealership there in Franklin, Tennessee. So I said, baby, why don't you call Stevie and see if you can talk to her about talking to her husband about maybe we can just kind of meet him and just kind of get a bottom line on a deal on a car. And she goes, if you want to talk to Stevie, you got a car. I go, okay. So I call Stevie up and say, hey, Stevie, it's Robbie. And she goes, who? I go, Robbie, I'm like, I'm married to Tina. She goes, no, I love Tina. I said, you know, Brian, oh, we love Brian because Brian was the same age as their daughter, Jessica, who turned 16 just a few weeks earlier than Brian did. And I was just kind of, as I was starting a conversation, she goes, I bet you want to talk to my husband, don't you? I said, man, I'd love to, because, man, I just kind of want to know, kind of get a bottom-line car deal. She goes, oh, I understand. She said, hold on a minute, and she put her husband on the phone. Stevie's husband is Daryl Waltrip, who owns a car dealership. The husband's like, what do you got on the phone? I didn't know whether to go like diggity what, you know? And Big D, he's like, hey, man, I want you to go down to the car dealership. You see Big John. Now, when I got down there, Big John was fitting. Because when I got to the car dealership, I said, Mr. Darrell, sit and see Big John. And Big John walks in, he's about 6'6". It's like, yeah, you Big John. He said, Mr. Darrell called. He said, here's what we're going to do. You look out there, you pick whatever car you want for your boy. Mr. Darrell told me a deal to give you. I'm going, that's the bottom line right there. I like the bottom line. This morning, we're going to look at a passage in God's Word that basically, it's the bottom line. If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 22, beginning in verse 34. I believe if you could take God's word, so to speak, and boil it down, melt it down, so to speak, to that one kind of that nugget of truth, the main thing, the bottom line, this would be it. As a matter of fact, in your copy of God's Word, if you're looking right now at Matthew chapter 22, we're going to also put it up on the screen this morning. Like my Bible, your Bible probably says this at the very top of the little caption above verse 34. Mine says this, the greatest commandment. It's like, hello? I'll be a little bit of a clue here. This is the bottom line. The greatest commandments. As you look at verse 34, this is how it opens up. It says, hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. Now, let me kind of point you a little biblical history here. Back in Jesus' day, there were two main, kind of pretty strong, kind of, they had their heels in the society, religious groups, the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Now, when Jesus showed up, Jesus was all about relationship, not religion. He was about changing lives, not being in a religious system. So when Jesus showed up, the people began to follow him. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, almost became sort of like the spiritual terrorists, the spiritual ISIS, maybe, so to speak, of the day. They did not like Jesus. Their goal was to shut him down. So here's what they do. Jesus would show up in a town or a village, and man, you know from reading God's word that when Jesus would show up and begin to teach in a synagogue or on a hillside or right on the side of the lake, thousands would show up. Well, not only thousands would show up, but also the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And when they showed up, here's what they would do. In the middle of Jesus' teaching, they would disrupt. They would jump up and down, wave, grab Jesus' attention, and Jesus would recognize them. He wasn't afraid. Point to them, and many times what they would do is they would ask Jesus questions to try to catch him off guard, to kind of stump him, to try to make him like, I don't have the answer to that. And why? Because they were hoping that if they could kind of stump Jesus, that in turn they could say to the crowd, look, he couldn't even answer that. He didn't even know that. Why are you following him? Well, it says here that Jesus silenced the Sadducees. Now, it's not that he said to them, hey guys, hey, we all hold it down over there. Hey, stop. Just be quiet. No, that's not what the word silence means. When it says that Jesus silenced the Sadducees, it basically means that he dumbfounded them. They were like, they almost like in a sense swallowed their tongues. They didn't know what else to ask, because in the previous verses, every question that they fired at Jesus, he answered. And they're just, don't have anything else to. So the Pharisees, not to be outdone, they said, the Sadducees, we can do better. So the Pharisees, since they got together, they huddled up, and they want to come up with their question that they can kind of stump Jesus, trip him up in front of the crowd. So it says here in verse 35, one of them, an expert in the law, pretty smart guy, you know what I'm saying? Not like me. I made like a 13 on ACT, you know what I'm saying? I don't got many kidneys up here, you know what I'm talking about? So one of them, an expert in the law, so he kind of stepped out from the group to step up to pose the question, to test Jesus with this question. Now here's the whole deal. Verse 36. This whole passage, this whole where it was going, where it was headed, made a huge 180 in a whole nother direction because of one word. That word is that first word in verse 36. where he said, teacher. And here's why. You see, in Jesus' day, the word teacher was one of the highest forms of endearment you could give someone. One of the highest forms of compliment, of respect you could give someone. In Jesus' day, when you called someone teacher, there was a sense of you were like, I'm underneath what your truth is. You have what I need. You've got the answers. When he said teacher, see, I believe back in here in the hole, he and his buddies, they had come up with the question. But I believe when he stepped out, because he had seen, he had heard everything Jesus had answered earlier, and all of a sudden began to register, this guy is not just a normal man. And I believe when he stepped up, the question that he was going to ask isn't the question that he asked. That all of a sudden it's like, I've got something I need to ask. When he said teacher, he's looking at Jesus and he's like, I need an answer. I need an answer. I'm hungry for truth. Teacher, this is what he asked. He said, what or which is the greatest commandment in the law? Now remember, the Pharisees, Sadducees, they were the religious people of that day. In Jesus' day, those religious people, and you do any study of it, they had so many rules and laws that they had to obey. As a matter of fact, many of them were in sequential order. And if you got through the sequential order of obeying certain things, and you were like, whatever, 7 or 8 in the sequential order, and you messed up, you sort of had to reverse and start all over again sometimes. So I believe in so many ways, he's like, man, I'm tired. I'm tired. I'm just doing this, and nothing's happening here. It's just doing, and I'm tired of doing, and I'm tired of repeating and doing and repeating. It's like, Jesus, it's like there's so many rules and little things about me. What's the one thing? In other words, it's like you saying, Jesus, what's the bottom line? What's just that one thing? You know, it kind of reminds me of like me when I was in high school. When I was in college, maybe you were like me when I was in graduate school. I was the guy in class that when we were coming toward test time, I would be raising my hands and the teacher, the professor, doc would be like, yes, Rob, hey, doc, can you tell us what's going to be on the test? Man, I can remember those times getting that piece of paper and it was test time and I'd be like, and there's only one part I could fill out, and that was that top part, Maine. You know, those times where I thought I studied the stuff that I needed to study, but what I studied in what they put on the test. And it's almost like this guy saying, in the test of life, so to speak, what's going to be the bottom line answer? What's the greatest commandment in all the law? You know, love it. You know, we have a Savior that doesn't leave us hanging. Doesn't leave us right on the edge. Well, let's see if you can. I love it. He asked the question. And you know what? God's Word just lays the truth out there, Pastor. What I'm going to say is like, there's no like, I wonder what God's trying to say. Look there. Verse 37, Jesus replied. Guy asked, I'm going to give you the answer. Jesus replied, he said this in verse 37, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. You can't step above it. There's not a higher rung on the ladder. This is it, to love God. You know, I'm not sure sometimes we really grasp. We really connect. I mean, I think we do what it means to love God. I mean, so many times we miscue that because, well, in America, we use love just, hey, man, I love pizza. I love my dog. Man, I love my team. I love my wife. It's not all the same. In the language of Jesus' day, there were four distinct words for the word love. And when you said that distinct word, you knew exactly what it meant. And here in America, we're emotive people. Man, if you're like me, and you sit through fall football season, I can get emotive. Woo! I get all jacked up. And if my team wins, dude, I'm in love. I'm happy. We even transfer that sometimes in the church. Man, the song that we connect with, man, I feel something. That must mean I love God. No, just means you know something. Pastor Mike brings the word, and it's just like, whoo, that was on, man. I mean, that tattooed my heart. It's good, but if we're not careful, we connect emotion with that. Well, senior of high school is when I get introduced to Jesus, and I received him. I invited him in my life to be my Savior. It was a group of friends that went to a very charismatic church. I mean, I remember when I went this, I mean, it wasn't like the little tidy whitey Baptist church that I went to every once in a while with my grandma and grandpa, you know? And I mean, they like, woo, tambourining, like, and so I would see everybody rushing and praying and hitting the aisles, and I thought, well, man, I've got to do that to show my love for Jesus. Now, there's nothing wrong with clapping, nothing wrong with lifting your hands, but just because I lift my hands, it doesn't mean I love God anymore. It doesn't mean you love Him more. I can't work love up. It's not an emotion toward God. You see, what we got to realize, this word love, when Jesus said love the Lord God, bottom line, this kind of overarching definition of love. Loving God is not an emotion. Rather, loving God's a commitment. It's a choice. It's a decision. See, emotions come and go. Feelings are here one day, gone the next. Team's up by 35 points, loses by 2. Whoa, emotions are gone. You know? Thank you, Nick Saban. Okay, we'll talk about that later. But, you know, I really kind of understood the difference between commitment versus emotion, decision versus a feeling, choice versus just a move. When I got married, I'll never forget, I was a junior at Belmont University. I was walking across the campus one day, and all of a sudden, oh, I saw her. I mean, she's a cute little sugar booger. I think I ever saw her. I mean, I climbed every mountain, so to speak. I swam every river, so to speak, to be around Tina Wolverton. Oh, and then that one day, I asked her out. And she said yes. I mean, all the girls said yes. And we began to date, and we fell in love. We don't fall in love, you fall in ditches, but for sake of a matter of term, you know, we fell in love, and then I planned out that moment. Oh man, I'm so proud of myself. I went to Wally World, bought that cubic zircon ring. That's right, my boy stepped up, you know what I'm saying? That's right. Planned that big special time to ask her the big question. Yeah, I went all out, baby. We went to McAdee's. I said, I'm so pumped up. I said, supersize, baby. Got through eating in the middle of it. I slipped out of my chair, got down on my knee. You know the moment's thing to happen. And I reach in my pocket, I pull out that little black box, and I open it up, and I pop that huge, all-important life question. Her eyes just huge, watered up. I could tell the emotion that was flooding her, the reality that she was going to get the privilege of spending life with me. I can imagine she was overcome. Not. Okay. She said yes. We planned the date, April 21st, 1979, Two Rivers Baptist Church, Nashville, Tennessee. I'll never forget the wedding. I'm at the back of the little area with Pastor Jimmy and met all the little groom's maids or whatever you call them, men, whatever, you know. And all of a sudden, Jimmy goes, "Dude, it's time." I'm going, "It's time." We come in, we take our spot, and, you know, Pastor Jimmy's up on the upper platform. I'm down here, and I'm all the groom's guys that are standing there. And then all of a sudden, I kind of lost presence. I'm like, I couldn't remember from the rehearsal the night before. Was I supposed to put my right hand over my left hand, my left hand over my right hand? And I'm just like, kind of confused. I'm looking at my mom. I'm going, "Mama, help me." She's just crying for that baby boy getting married. She can't help. I look at my dad, so he'd be like, "No more help for you." You know? All right. And the music's playing. One girl comes in, I'm going, "That ain't her." Another comes in, and all of a sudden, oh, those seven notes. Dun, 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 dun. Oh man, you should have you love Tina. Oh, I love Tina. I'm hearing Bob Barker, "Come on down." Here she appears at the back of the church in that beautiful white Floyd wedding gown. Man, as the lights kind of shimmered and shined off those beautiful, I mean dark, beautiful brown eyes of hers, I was making up poems in my head. I'm thinking, "Twinkle, twinkle, a little star. Hello, baby. Here I are." Man, they come down the aisle on our 6'5" father, my father-in-law, Jerry Wolverton. Kid down the front, I stand on this side, he's right there, she's right there. And Jimmy, Pastor Jimmy says, "Who's giving this man to be married, this woman to be married, this man?" And her father says, "Her mother and I," and he steps out and he places her arm in mine. At that point, I could hear some James Brown there. And we stepped up those three steps up to the platform, exchanged the rings, the vows, did the little UDT candle, had a little prayer, altar time, and then Pastor Jimmy stood and he pronounced us husband and wife. And then he looked at me and said, "Robbie, now you can kiss your bride." I'm like, "Yes, I can." I'm like, "Dude, I had 500 buddies of mine there from high school and college. Guys I played ball with. I mean, listen, in my mind, I could not wait to lift the veil and lay this just huge magno kiss on her to where my buddies were literally standing up in the pews going, "Hoo, hoo, hoo, hoo." And when I lifted the veil, all of a sudden, now, all throughout the ceremony, Tina cried. I understood why she was crying, to get overwhelmed, realizing she was getting me for life. Maybe it was the other reason she was crying, you know. But you know, in our heads we had these little sinus pockets that carry fluid. That when we cry, the fluid is released out of our nose upon our lip bone. So therefore, as I raise the veil, I see what floweth upon her lip, and all of a sudden, my emotions went, they were gone. It was Bye Bye Miss American Pie, drive your own Chevy to the levee, you know what I'm saying? And all of a sudden, it was emotion versus commitment, a feeling versus a choice, decision. And I'm like, "You love her, right, Robin?" "Yeah, but I don't like what I see." Robin, you want your buddies to know you're not kissing on the cheek. You're going to throw that kiss on her because you've been playing throwing and throwing over your friends, right? Right? And then I laid the biggest fat kiss on her I could. You know what? It wasn't that bad. Loving God is not an emotion. emotion. It's a choice. It's not a feeling. It's a decision. It's not something you work up. To love the Lord God, he said, with how much? All of your heart, your soul, your mind. Not some, not part. 24-7, Luke 14:33. Jesus said, you want to follow me, you must be willing to give your all. Can you imagine? I really can, but I mean, just follow me here. What did Pastor Seth got up here? At the end of the service today, Pastor Mike, all of a sudden, we begin to stand, and the words got up on the screen, and we're going to sing that incredible, awesome song of consecration, of dedication, of commitment toward Jesus. And all of a sudden, this Pastor Seth begins to lead us. And as we begin to sing, we're confused because all of a sudden that song that we've known so well, that we've sung so many times, that has such deep, strong, real meaning, all of a sudden goes like this. Son, to Jesus I surrender part. To him I freely give. No. It's all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. 24-7. What did Jesus say? You want to follow me? Luke 9:23. You must deny yourself and take up your cross daily. You know, that's the hardest part about the Christian walk, don't you? That one word. Daily. I can do Sunday. We can do Sunday. I love people. I love to worship. But it's not about Sunday. It's about Monday morning at work. It's about Friday night. It's about when you're on a business trip and nobody but you in that hotel room. It's 24-7. All. Not part. Not some. All. To love the Lord God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul. And see, what we've done so many times with Jesus is, let's just say, my Bible represents Jesus. Now, we know it's a Bible, but just for illustration purposes, it represents Jesus. What we've done, we think we've done pretty good. What we've done is we're like, well, Jesus is a part of my life. I've got my family. Man, I've got my job. I've got, maybe God's blessing. Then I got my lake house in Lake Martin or wherever it is. And man, I got Jesus. And then when Sunday comes around, in mission trip, other things, man, I do Jesus. But it's almost like we like I said, he's like just another thing in our life that we care about, but Sunday's over and we'll pick up Jesus next week. No, when Jesus is all, heart, mind, soul, see that all, that round whole rounding together really comes to one word, the word Lord. Lord. He becomes Lord of our lives. And when he's Lord of our lives, he's not just another thing in our life. Not just as important as, oh, my family and, oh, my job. No. He becomes the center, the core, heartbeat of our life. And out of him being the core heartbeat of our life flows how we are at work. How we treat our family. How we choose to live when no one's looking. Lord, I had a cool privilege. I was speaking at a church outside Jackson, Mississippi, been a few years ago. I think it's kind of cool because I mentioned Pastor Mike, that was my wife and I was coming up on our 25th anniversary. Somebody in the church came up to me and said, hey, have you and your wife ever been to Hawaii? And I'm like, nah, I've been to Alabama. They go, I mean, like, we were like thinking, my husband and I, that We have a condo over in Maui. We'd love to give you guys a week over there. And I'm like, for a moment, like, hello, did I just, hello? Can you say that again? I'm like, we would love to accept that gift. Man, T and I, we flew over there. It's unbelievable. I'm just pinching myself all week, you know. Going, this isn't quite like Huntsville, but it's nice. And we're in a Christian bookstore over there in Valley. I do this a lot. I like different Bible translations. And matter of fact, you know, I've got like in my little carrier here, because my Bible, I've got, you know, the Bible app on my phone, and I've got all the, I love those different translations. I look at them. I noticed when I was in the bookstore, Christian bookstore, they had a number of different translations, and one of them kind of caught my eye was, I saw it said, Hawaiian Indigenous Bible. I'm like, and I pulled it out and I realized the Wycliffe Bible translators, they translate the Bible into indigenous languages around the world, so they grasp it, because certain words in every language means different in different areas of the world. So the Hawaiian Indigenous Bible, I'll open up, I'm kind of flipping through it. I will always kind of pinpoint and look at certain words. Just, I wonder what the word, what they say for that word. And I kept looking at different parts to find the word Lord, like where it says Lord Jesus Christ, or Jesus Christ is Lord, or the Lord. And every time I saw the word Lord, I was like, oh, that's good. Because in the Hawaiian Indigenous Bible, and I've got my copy at home, it says this. Like, it says where Jesus Christ is Lord, or Lord Jesus Christ, it says Jesus Christ is Boss Man. I want to say, Boss Man Jesus. I get that. You know what I'm saying? I get that. See, when he's Lord, he's Boss Man. He's Boss Man. He's not just another thing in our lives. And we, it's not like we just, we did it just like we but it's kind of just happens. We forget he's not just another thing in our lives that we incorporate. He is our life. Boss Man. When I was a staff at Brentwood Baptist Church, Pastor Mike, before I began traveling full time, I was kind of positioned. You are Pastor Matt, associate in student ministry, and different things, you know. Kind of whatever the pastor didn't want to do that day, I can't do that. Like, that's what associate means. Come on, jump on it, baby. That's all right. And we had a ministry downtown called Room in the Inn. I don't know if y'all know what Room in the Inn is, but that's where we would go downtown Nashville at the National Rescue Mission, get somewhere about 10 to 15 homeless guys in a church van, bring them back to the church. Pastor Mike, they would stay at the church. We had a gym there. On Saturday, we'd prepare some of the different, maybe another Sunday school class or a small group would prepare a meal. We'd have a meal with the guys, and the senior high boys, me and guys, they kind of owned that ministry, and they would spend the night in the gym with the homeless guys, shooting hoops, hanging out. We also had a clothes closet. Guys need some clothes, they could grab some. Sunday morning, we had a special class for them, and then they worshiped with us. Well, one of the first times I went downtown, I just connected with one of the homeless guys. His name was James. And I think while I connected, we just kind of started talking about old school wrestling, like Ric Flair, oh, you know, and different ones. Man, I remember, dude, I'll tell you what, man, my first wrestling experience, when I was a little boy, my granddaddy took me to see Gorgeous George Jr. Now, some of y'all are like, who's that? Some of y'all are like, oh, I know that one. He was original, okay? Hello. So when we started talking about wrestling, man, and well, my grandpa, one time I tried to tell him it wasn't real, he was like, what'd you say? I was like, no, I'm joking, Grandpa. I was just playing with you. Yeah. So, but So we just kind of connected, and the next month, we did this once a month, and we went down, and changed on that bus again. We just hit it up, talked more. Third month, we went down, changes on that bus again. Sunday morning, during the time of the response invitation, James came to me, I was on that side. James came to me and said, "Pastor Robbie, I want Jesus." So we sat down, Pastor Mike, right there, you know my father, and just walked through God's word about what it meant that Jesus went to the cross for him. And then we've all fallen short. We can't do it on our own. We need a Savior. And then even though we've sinned, we've blown it, God loved us that much. And how God's word says in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door," Jesus said, "I will come in." I said, "James, would you like to open the door of your life and invite Christ to come in to be your Savior, to be your Lord?" He said, "Absolutely, Robbie." Right there, he bowed his head, closed his eyes, and prayed a simple prayer that he did with all his heart, where he invited Jesus Christ to step out of heaven, to come in his heart life, to be his Savior. He got to pray that prayer, dude, he gave him this huge old hug. And when we got to praying that prayer, I'm thinking, man, I'm going to ask him. And I asked him, I said, "James, hey, I'm asking a homeless guy this question." I said, "Did you have a Bible?" And then I said, "You know, sometimes you ask somebody a question, you're like, that was dumb." And he kind of looks at me like, "I'm homeless. I got nothing." And I'm like, "Dude, I need to get you a Bible." Now, in my office as associate pastor, Matt, I kept all the Bibles on one of my shelves that, like, if somebody needed a Bible, if somebody, a brand new believer, needed a Bible, somebody who's visitor didn't have a Bible, and found out we'd give them a Bible. Well, I remember noticing on the shelf, it was that morning when the boss didn't have any Bibles up there, and I just kind of remember thinking that. So I'm sitting there next to James, Pastor Mike, and I was like, "Oh, James, listen. Now, you might come for 3 months in a row," and said, "James, I'm going to come next month. Here's the deal. Next month, when you come, I'm going to have you a Bible." Now, when I said that, "Next month, when you come, I'm going to have you a Bible," the Holy Spirit was like, "What?" It's like the Holy Spirit said, "Wait a minute here. This guy just found the truth. Just opened his heart, invited Jesus to come in. And you're going to let him go a month without reading the most important book ever written? The book of instruction, the book of life. You're going to wait a month, and on the inside I'm having a conversation with the Holy Spirit. I'm going, I don't have it. There's no Bibles on the shelf." That, it was an inside conversation, because I guarantee you, if I'd have kind of had an allied conversation with the Holy Spirit, that homeless guy would look at me like, "Okay, you're weird." As I'm having this inside conversation with the Holy Spirit, I'm like, "No, I have a Bible." The Holy Spirit said, "Yeah, you've got a Bible. You can get it." And I'm thinking, "Where do I have a Bible?" The Holy Spirit said, "In your hand." I'm thinking, "That's my Bible." And the Holy Spirit, "Yeah, you remember when you went to Lifeway Christian Bookstore last week and you bought it? And the little lady who embossed his name on the front of the Bible wasn't there, so you couldn't get your name embossed on the Bible? Guess what? That ain't your Bible, Bobo." And I'm like, "Okay, Holy Spirit." You know, on the outside, I'm like the homeless guy. I'm like, "Dude, I've got a Bible for you." On the inside, I'm going, "Okay, Holy Spirit, I'll do what you say." Yeah. I remember just fighting the Holy Spirit of God on it. And I remember just handing that Bible like that and saying, "James, here's your Bible." I will never forget. Folks look on his face, the person's like, "All right." I said, "James, it's yours, bro." He reached over with one hand, pulled it in, and with the other hand, just cradled it for a moment. My heart melted. It's like God said, "Have you forgotten how precious the Word is?" I got a fair amount of travels all over the world. There's places in the world that don't have God's Word. There's places in the world that, when they're failed with copies of God's Word, they're persecuted, killed, annihilated. And some of us have so many copies laying around our house, we have to dust it off, so we just move it, you know, to another shelf. I grabbed him and said, "Hey," I said, "James, let me show you something." He's kind of hesitant. I said, "It's your Bible." I said, "Hey, James," I opened up. I said, "I'll show you. Here's the book in the Bible. Look at it. Named after you. James. He's like, no way. Now, that's not what he really said, but I can't say because we're in church. And by the way, you know, you're Christian, so you know, it takes time for language to change. But like, yeah, dude, James. He goes, wow. And so I said, hey, I showed him there's five chapters. I said, here's what I want you to do, James. When you get up tomorrow, if you don't have anything to do, homeless guy, if you don't have anything to do, I said, I want you to read chapter one. On Tuesday, read chapter two. Wednesday, three. Thursday, four. Friday, check, find out. On Saturday, Sunday, there's a middle book in the Bible. It's called Psalms. Now, there's a P, but the P is silent. You know, I mean, just, you know, like how your mama used to tell you growing up. But hell, you know, like, it looks like post Psalms, but it's Psalms. I said, come on, David, just pick him. Open it up, learn the language, read one of the chapters. He goes, okay. Now, month went by, Pastor Matt. I didn't go down that Saturday with the senior high guys and a couple of my leader men. And Sunday morning, I'm just walking down the hall of church, Pastor Mike, and all of a sudden, I hear somebody go, Pastor Robbie, Pastor Robbie. And I turn, and it's James, homeless dude. He's front beeline to Pastor Robbie. He goes, dude, that book of James? He said, that's some powerful stuff. I said, yeah, it is. He said, now, I was okay with you on Monday. That first day, I couldn't stop at one chapter. I read the whole book. I said, that's okay. He said, on Tuesday, the whole book. On Wednesday, the whole book. He said, every day that I read every chapter in the book of James, every day. He said, Saturday, I got up like 3 weeks ago. You know, you told me, and I also told him this after he's read that, I said, take a piece of paper. And on that piece of paper, write down all the things God says to you through the book of James. He reaches in his front little tattered shirt pocket and pulls out a torn, brown, grocery sack piece of paper. Folded up. And he goes, I got it, Pastor Robbie. I wrote down all the things God said to me in the book of James like you told me to write down. And of course, I'm thinking, where's the big piece of paper? I mean, he's like, and you got a little torn, and he hands it to me. And I open up this one small, I still got it at home, small piece of paper written in number two lead pencil. One simple sentence. Written by a brand new believer who read through the book of James five times. This is what he wrote. He said, if you love God, prove it. If you love God, prove it. Let's pray together. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Lord, heads bowed, eyes closed before the Lord, Pastor Eli. And come forward this time. Take this time of response and invitation. So with our heads bowed, eyes closed, Pastor Eli.